hello everyone. It's a great pleasure for me to be here to tell you about a particular type of reenactment, the Gallo-Roman religious practices. From the range of animations proposed in the area, this type of reenactment remains uncommon compared to craftwork and handling, weapon handling demonstrations. However, they are to me very interesting to study from the point of view of communicating archaeology with general public. This reconstruction indeed refer to central social practices in the lives of the Gallo-Romans. They are therefore very representative of the way of thinking and operating. Like all Indo-European civilizations, the Gallo-Romans were really deeply ritualistic, and they knew no difference between the laic and the religious worlds. The gods were everywhere, and it was important to please them with offerings and sacrifice, and to consult their opinion with divination. Beyond religious beliefs, the ritual also had some political and social significance and ensured unity of society. Presenting these religious practices to living history is therefore an opportunity to address these important issues with the general public and help to picture the Gallo-Roman civilization beyond its material culture. But how can we do this? Can we do this concretely? How do we help the public understand the specificity of the Gallo-Roman religion? Among the multitude of known rituals, how to choose the most representative? How do we help the public project themselves in a universe so different from ours to experience this ritualism? And finally, what information should we give to the public to provide the necessary case to understand it? All these problems involve choices. To reflect on these questions, I will not present a project that I predicted myself, but I will recount several examples I witnessed and studied as part of my PhD work. This example illustrates various options and possibilities that can be used. Between 2012 and 2013, I was able to document about 15 reenactments of Gallo-Roman rituals in Switzerland and in France. They were organized during living history festivals with or without the implication of museum or archaeological sites. I was able to observe various types of religious ceremonies. The most common are the large-scale worships dedicated to either the emperor or major deities of the pantheon, such as Jupiter. These types of ceremonies is the most documented in ancient texts as well as inscription and iconography. It combines the majority of rites practiced in the Roman Empire, including procession, purification, prayer, sacrifice, divination, and banquets. The rituals are also large and spectacular, that lend themselves well to a large audience. It's therefore not surprising that most of the reenactors have chosen to reconstruct these rites. This being said, I also observe some more original attempts. For example, a reconstitution of Vinalia rustica, an agrarian ritual celebrating the beginning of the harvest. A private cult dedicated to a minor god of the native pantheon. Some military rituals. Some rites of passage, including for a wedding, a baptism, and also an enfranchisement of state. And finally, some magical rituals. These types of reenactments are, however, much more uncommon, but have the merit of presenting the diversity of religious practices of antiquity. In most cases, these reenactments are linked to the archaeological context of the sites where they are being held. Most of them took place directly above the ruins or in close proximity to cult sites. For example, in Nîmes, the rite took place on a platform constructed in front of La Maison Carrée, a temple dedicated to the imperial cult, located on a Roman on the Roman Forum and very well preserved, as you can see. Another example, at Augst, the reenactment took place directly on the remains of the temple of the Forum, highlighted, as you can see, by an elevation of the facade. The reenactors even use the original altars of the temple dating back to 50 AD, which is still displayed on the site. Finally, the ritual at Petinesca was organized in the remains of the sanctuary of Umboden, initially built in the 1st century AD. You can see a restitution below. In this particular case, the festival and the ceremony were planned specially to celebrate the new presentation panels of the sanctuary. Beyond the material remains, still visible but often difficult to understand for the visitors, such reenactment allowed to imagine the gatherings taking place in such sites and to reconstitute intangible aspects of this event. During festivals, these ceremonies are presented as one of the highlights of the program. They often serve as opening ceremonies of the festival or as central events. If you've got the program of the Römerfest of Augusta Raurica of this year, which presents for the first highlight a reconstitution of cult tombs. And as you can see on this picture, the public typically attends in large audience, proof of his interest in this very particular type of reenactment. To achieve this reconstruction, the groups often get the assistance of experts, historians, or archaeologists. And they seem to take this work very seriously, because these reenactments distinguish themselves as a high scientific quality. For example, the reconstruction of the costumes is often excellent, clearly inspired by the literary description, archaeological finds, and iconography at our disposal. In some cases, we can see an apex, just here, which is the traditional hat of the flamen presented on the arapakis in Rome and on some coins. The attributes of the priest and the instrumentum for the cult are also well respected, like the liturus, the aspergillum, or the pachel. The altars with fireplace are well reconstructed, and it's also the case for the different types of offerings like meat, fruits, cereals, incense, flowers, or wine. On the other end, we have no clear description of the gestures associated with the rituals, which pose some difficulties for the reenactors. Some engage in very solemn movements. They proclaim their prayer to the god in very theatrical display. Others, certainly inspired by ethno-archaeological comparison, choose a less spectacular presentation. Their gestures are fast and precise, perhaps illustrating better the repetitiveness of these rituals performed several times a day by the Gallo-Roman. It is also interesting to note that the reconstruction of religious practices often make direct reference to the specifics of the site. As an example, we can mention the reenactment of a cult to Epona presented at Petinesca. This demonstration directly refers to one of the archaeological discoveries from the site, a pair of miniature hipposandals. This object, taken to be an ex voto, attests the cult of the Celtic goddess at Petinesca. Another example in Bern, one of the reenactors, playing a magistrate, provides thanks in his opening speech of the sanctuary to various patrons, including the Otacilii family. This allusion is a reference to an inscription found on the site. It indicates that the temple was offered by an Otacilius Zecus, Doumbé of the city of Aventico. A last example, at Autun and Nîmes, the cult is done in the presence of the Emperor Adrian. It is a reference to the journey of the emperor in the south of Gaul between 121 and 122 AD. This anecdote, reported by the Historia Augusta, allows to refer to a regional historical event. As we have seen, many festivals often offer reenactments of major public ceremonies. These rites, organized sometimes over several days during antique festivities, were at the time some complex enterprises. It's therefore interesting to see what steps and sequences the reenactors have chosen to present to the public. The first step of the traditional ritus romanus is a probatio, which consists in the selection and preparation of the victim. As you can see on this summary table, in all the examples I presented, the probatio was never reenacted. The second step, The ritual procession called Pompa was seen only twice. This procession is, however, very spectacular and allows to integrate the public. He can participate as a faithful who were following sacred procession to the sanctuary. It was the case here in Petinesca with the school children of the city. Overall, the reenactors focus on preliminary rituals involving consecration and purification of the sanctuary, silence requests, invocation of the gods, and offerings of wine and incense. It's interesting to note that only two groups risk the reconstitution of the bloody sacrifice step, the immolation. Most of the groups limited themselves to vegetable offerings. While these offerings did exist, they were always accompanied by a sacrifice during large public cults. In this case, their absence negatively affects the credibility of proposed reconstructions. On the two reenactments that included this test, only one addressed the sacrifice of the animal, meaning the action. In the other, an already dead chicken was presented. It is true that the potential reenactment of the killing of an animal is particularly problematic, given laws, modern sensibilities, and a family audience. But this lack of body sacrifice still retains a very attenuated image of the religious ceremonies of the antiquity. Finally, the divination was never presented. Similarly, the sharing and consumption of meat is never mentioned. This is unfortunate, as current research demonstrated that it represents the most important part of the sacrifice, expressing major social roles. Because the ritus romanus is a complex exercise, all reenactments of ceremonies are accompanied by a commentary given either by an external commentator in costume or by one of the reenactors playing a character. So we can see typically two different cases for mediation. In the first case, the reenactor introduces the ritual and then performs the restitution without further explanation of the various stages. The audience attends the rite, often reenacted in Latin, with or without translation. This will be accompanied by music and scents of fire and incense with proper staging. All of this creates an atmosphere conducive to lead the visitor to a strong sense of immersion. This program, however, implies a restriction of information. Why is the ram sprinkled with flour? And what is this funny small whisk the priest waves around? The spectator will not have the answer unless they are specialists. For this reason, and in most cases, the reenactors choose to add a step-by-step commentary of the ritual. The amount of information is more important. Spectators learn what mola salsa is and what an aspergillum is, for example. However, this content commentary, often given with a microphone, prevents a proper projection and immersion in the atmosphere of Roman times. So this type of mediation can sometimes more resemble an illustrated presentation than actual . In this context of presentation, the interaction between the public and the reenactors is also lower than in other types of reconstructions. I think, for example, of stand with craftwork demonstration where visitors have the opportunity to discuss directly with the craftsman and even to test some of the techniques themselves. Some groups are still trying to involve the public in the ceremony by, for example, portraying the Gallo-Roman faithfuls in attendance at worship. In Bern, the commentator addressed the public by calling them the people of Brenodor. In Nîmes, the reenactors went even further and would yell at the crowd, "Patito lingua," which means hold your tongue, as a Roman priest had the habit of doing for the smooth running of the rituals. The commentator also invited the public to cover their hand during the rite and to join the celebrants for a prayer to Jupiter. The organizers had planned a panel to facilitate the participation of the audience. The Museum of Saint-Romain-en-Gal in France attempted a more intimate approach. During the reconstruction of a wedding, the commentator took a few members of the public for the role of the main protagonists, such as the bride, the groom, or their parents. They are provided costume and follow the indication of the commentator step by step, laughing and exclaiming at the interesting bridal habits of the Romans. This concept is set halfway between a presentation, a show, and a role play. It's really interesting because it allows to integrate the public directly in the reenactment for an improved experience and understanding. But the system, of course, only works in small groups. So, overall, the example I presented are characterized by their focus on the sharing of advanced knowledge and the scientific quality of the reenacted elements. Because they attract a large audience, there seems to be a great communication. However, because they principally focus on the reenactment of large public rituals, these reconstitutions still provide a very spectacular image of Roman religion, and in the end, a quite partial one. The community aspect of the ceremonies, the importance of the rites, and the omnipresence of the god are not properly highlighted. The reality of such worship seems also attenuated compared to the literary description or with ethno-archaeological comparisons. Of course, this type of reenactment is still in its early first stages, and it has good development prospects, given that researchers and mediators have already started to work together on this project. One interesting perspective could be to further look at the private aspect of the Gallo-Roman religion. Why not propose reenactment of domestic rituals around a agrarian or of ex-voto? These rituals are less spectacular, but they are perhaps more representative of the daily religious habits of the Gallo-Romans. Despite of the difficulty, it is still important to propose reenactment of religious practices in the Festival of Living History, alongside the ritual craftwork demonstration, procession of legionaries, and gladiator shows. Religious practices are part of the heritage of the people, as recalled by the UNESCO in its 2003 convention. Culture cannot be understood only in its material aspect. From oral tradition to Navajo and social and religious practices, all are essential parts of a rich and distant culture. The reenactment of Gallo-Roman religious practices have the merit of raising these matters with the public and are therefore appropriated within the living history. And they might even bring some impulse to it. I thank you for your attention.